sleep, the talk is basically about what sleep is doing for us. There's this common belief that, you know, when you're asleep, the brain shuts off, the body lies down, and nothing happens. And that's really not what's going on. It's a little bit like a fairy tale. And in fact, the elves and the shoemaker fairy tale is about my story tonight. So here's the story. The shoemaker, who was a poor shoemaker, had just enough leather left for one pair of shoes. He cut out the leather for two pairs of shoes, and then as it was late, he left the pieces on the bench, ready to sew in the morning. But when morning came, two pairs of shoes lay on the bench, most beautifully made, and no sign of anyone who had been there. Well, what I want to tell you is that this is not a fairy tale. This is what happens for us each and every night. And that sleep, in fact, is sewing together the pieces of our memory. And I'm going to walk you through four examples of this just to show you how powerful it is. I'm going to show you how when you sleep, your brain will extract from experiences the gist of what happened. It'll extract the gist and kind of forget all those details that weren't so important. It'll discover the rules of our lives. It'll take large amounts of experiences and take them all together and figure out what the rules are that explain how our worlds work. It'll foster insight. It'll let us come up with those insights that are so critical and so powerful and so exciting when we have. And dreaming, in fact, is probably part of this entire process. And I'll show you some new findings that suggest that that's true. So let's start with the idea of sleep extracting the gist. In this study, we had subjects listen to lists of words spoken to them. Imagine that you're sitting in a room, and here are the instructions. You're going to hear a series of words broken up into lists of about a dozen words each. We want you to remember the words because later on we'll give you a blank piece of paper and ask you to write down all the words you can remember. And I'll give you an idea of what that feels like by taking you through one of those lists. Now, there's going to be a test at the end, okay? And you're going to have to raise your hands. And so I'm going to give you a lesson in medicine. On the back of the arm, there's a muscle, which is an extensor muscle, that makes the arm go out, okay? This is not raising your hand. This is not raising your hand. You have to use that muscle and actually lift your hand because we're doing the experiment right here now. Okay, so here's the instructions. Watch these words as they go by. Remember them. You're going to be tested. That's not supposed to happen. Okay, end of the list. So normally subjects would hear about a dozen of these lists and then be tested for recall. They would then come back maybe 20 minutes later or maybe 12 hours later and be tested on it. We're going to do it now. If you saw each of these words, raise your hand, okay? If you did see it. Okay, lots of yeses. A lot of weak extensor muscles, okay? Cotton. You see cotton? No. Okay, nobody for cotton. That, okay. And I don't know why that plus is in the middle. Okay. Doctor?
No.
Well, don't say it. They were going to raise their hands. Okay. So if I had done this competently, about half of you would have raised your hand for doctor. And you do that because the list is a gimmick list. We put together a whole bunch of words related to doctor, but we don't include the word doctor in the list. And it turns out that about half of you will falsely remember that you saw the word doctor because your brain is busy extracting the gist of the list. So we asked the question, if instead of testing you right away, and we would have you write down those words, if you had to come back 12 hours later and do it, how much would you forget? And the question is, what happens if we train you in the morning and test you in the evening compared to training you in the evening and testing you the next morning after a night of sleep? Okay, so what difference does sleep make to that kind of memory? Well, the first thing you see is that across the day or the night, you forget somewhere between 25 and 45% of the words that you would have remembered based on other subjects after just 20 minutes. And you actually forget less over the night. So that's an important factor. You will remember more of this list if you've slept on it than if you've gone through your day after you first see it. But that's the words you actually saw. What happens to those words that you didn't see, those gist words? Well, across the day, you still forget about 20% of them. But over a night of sleep, you actually get a little bit better on it. It's as if when you sleep, your brain is figuring out what it's about, it's holding on to that information, and it's throwing out all the rest. So over a series of days, in fact, what we see is that all that people remember are those words that weren't on the list, because you've extracted that gist, and that's what you hold on to. And as we do that in life, it looks like it's sleep, not waking, that allows us to extract that gist. So when we figure out what the take-home message is, we do it in our sleep. Now, interestingly, subjects also come up with words that weren't on the list and weren't the gist words either. So they come up with words like blood, which is probably from that doctor list. They think of it because of that. Someone else came up with the word plate, and you can see one of the lists was about cups or spoon, and one of the lists was about cup. That's pretty common when you do this study. But with this 12-hour interval, we started to see funny words popping up like fuzzy. I mean, where did that come from? And we thought, well, maybe from rough, or maybe from the list of words about soft, but it's really not either of those. And we get the word swirl. Where did that come from? And Jessica Payne, my student, said, well, maybe it came from mountain, like they were imagining clouds, or soft, you know, like some swirly, soft fabric. But then some other people said, well, no, maybe it's cup. Like, you know, you swirl your cup, coffee, or chair, you swirl your chair. And it started to feel like what these people are doing is they're coming up with words that don't just epitomize one list, but are now sort of starting to bring all the lists together. And when she looked, it finds out that you're not getting those creative intrusions so much when you're awake, you're getting them when you're asleep. So again, it's when you're sleeping that the brain is doing this work of pulling everything together and seeing how it fits together and how to summarize it. So there were a series of 9 digits. 1449494 is what it should have looked like, with that 94 up there. And you have to process this list to get an answer. And here's how you can do it. You can take the first 2 digits. If they're the same, there was a 1 and a 1. You see those are the top ones there? If they're the same, you just write that down. That's your intermediate answer. And then you take the 1 and the 4. And if they were the same, you'd write it down again. But because they're different, you take the third possibility, which is 9, because there's only 1s, 4s, and 9s, and you write down the 9. There we go. Then you take the 9 and the 4, and the third possibility is, anybody? 1, because they're 1s, 4s, and 9s. Then you take the 1 and the 9, and you put down a 4, and you take the 4 and the 4. They're the same. We use the other rule, you put down 4 again. Now this is tricky because it's really on the other line. You take the 4 and the 9 that got put on the next line, and they're different, so you put the 1, you take the 1 and the 4, and you get a 9. And that's the answer, and then you push return, and it tells you right or wrong, and you go on. If you don't quite understand it, neither do any of the subjects. But over a period of about 10 trials, they get it. And then over the next 100 trials, they get really bored, because they're just doing the same thing over and over by this rote method. Now, it turns out, unbeknownst to them, there's a trick, okay? And the trick is that the last 3 numbers they generate, the 4, the 1, and the 9, in this case, are always a mirror image of the 3 answers before it, a 9 and a 1 and a 4, right? That's the same sequence backwards, which means that that second number you got, that 9, is the answer. And you can just hit return there and get out of there about 80% faster. Maybe even make it home in time for dinner. So that's the trick you're supposed to discover, but you're not told that there's a trick. You're not told that there's an easier way to do it. The question is, can you just figure it out? Now, in the course of this 100 trials that students are are practicing this in the first session, about 10% of them actually figure out the rule. And they take those guys out back and they shoot them. But the rest of them, they send away. They send them away for 12 hours and bring them back. And then they give them another couple of hundred trials to see who can figure it out. Well, what do they find out? If they train people in the morning and then test them that evening 12 hours later, about a quarter of them, 25%, will figure it out over the course of those 200 trials. If they train them in the evening and keep them awake all night and test them in the morning, you get about the same thing, about 25% figure it out. But if you let them sleep on it, that's the only thing you're doing differently. You're letting them sleep. 2.5 times as many people figure it out. So you can gain these insights when you didn't even know there was an insight to find just by sleeping on it. It's an amazing phenomenon. It really is. It's like, how does it do it? I want to end with a fourth example, which is how dreaming seems to be part of this, because it actually could give us a theory of the brain, but I don't have time for that today. This is an example where people are trying to learn to navigate in a three-dimensional maze, one of those computer games that we don't play but our kids play, you know, where they're moving around it. And the trick is you have to learn during training how to navigate through this maze. And then 5 hours later, we test you on it and see how good you are at getting to certain places in the maze. And there's two groups of subjects. They're all trained at noon. They're all tested at 5 p.m. And half of them get to take a nap. Okay? That's the only difference. They get a nap. Losers, right? Well, it turns out that at retest, the people who didn't take a nap take about a minute longer to get through the maze than it did at the end of training. And the people who took the nap are about a minute faster. So again here, and now only with a 90-minute nap, you're seeing the brain is actually getting better at what it had been able to do before. But this is a study done by a student of mine, Erin Walmsley, who's really into dreams. So she added another study. She started waking people up from the naps and saying, "What are you dreaming?" And the people in the wake group who are just sitting there and watching a video, she'd say, "What's going through your mind?" And she asked, "What about the people who are dreaming about it or not dreaming about it, or thinking about it or not thinking about it in the wake group?" Well, in the wake group, it really doesn't make any difference whether they were thinking about it or not. They're still doing not particularly any better than they were at the end of training. And actually, those in the nap group who didn't report dreaming about it weren't particularly doing any better either. But the ones who reported dreaming about it were showing 10 times more improvement. So somehow, if nothing else, these dreams are a marker, a predictor, that the brain is going to do what it needs to do to really figure this maze out. Now, we got so excited, we started looking at these reports. Here's what the reports from the wake subjects look like. Well, I was thinking about the game that I used to play in high school, Counter-Strike, because it's the same layout, and also I was just planning and trying to remember the maze and trying to figure out the route. Or another one says, "I was thinking about what we have to do in the second maze test, wondering if it was going to be like the same." Those could help. You could imagine thinking about it that way could help. But it didn't. Those people in the red bar didn't particularly get any better at all. So what were the dreams that were so helpful? Well, I was thinking about the maze and kind of having people at checkpoints. There's no checkpoints and no people in the maze. And then it led me to think about when I went on this trip a few years ago and we went down to these bat caves and how they were kind of like mazes. Great, all right? How about this one? You like this one? Oh, I was kind of looking for something in a maze. Or how about this one? I was just hearing the music from the game. These are not dreams that you would expect to help. But those are the people who show 10 times more improvement. And what that seems to tell us is that the brain is processing this information as a whole brain. You know, got the whole food store, so we got the whole brain store here. And that when you're asleep, the brain is processing this information at multiple levels. So part of the brain is stabilizing and enhancing those memories and integrating all the different information from all you're exploring in the maze. And that's probably happening down in that ancient brain that they were talking about. The hippocampus is the structure that seems to hold that kind of information. It's extracting rules and the gist, maybe getting a sense of how that maze works. And that sort of work in the brain is what's going to make you better at it after you wake up. But that's not what you dream about. What you dream about are other things the brain is doing. It's integrating new and old memories so that in the future, when you are in a cave, you'll say, you know what, I've navigated through a maze once, and I've learned some tricks about how you do this. And that information from the maze game is suddenly useful when you're down in that bat cave. And it imagines possible futures. That's something the brain does while you're sleeping. And it's these last two that is what we see in our dreams. Those are the brain processes that we have access to, that we perceive, that we think are happening when we dream. And when you take all of these things together, what you're doing is you're creating the meaning of your lives. Because when we talk about the meaning of events in our life, what we're really talking about is how this event fits in with everything else. Remember after September 11th, we all walked around saying, I don't understand what happened. Well, guys, it was easy. Big plane, lots of fuel, high speed, big building. I mean, what's to understand? Well, what's to understand is, I work in a 12-story building. Should I go to work tomorrow? I've got plane tickets to Amsterdam in a week. Should I cancel my flight? I'm getting on the subway and there's a guy in front of me who kind of looks Arab, whatever that means, and he's got a big backpack on. Should I turn and run? When we create meaning in our lives, we learn how to take those events in our life and fit them in with all the other events in our life and use that, as the first clip showed, to predict the future. And of course, after September 11th, none of us could predict the future, and we felt that. But that's what our dreams do, and that's what our brain does while we sleep. So, like a nocturnal elf, our sleep sews those pieces together, leaving us in the morning with something better than a pair of shoes, with an understanding of our lives. So get some sleep. Thank you.